This week on the Internet Cafe, the Grim Reaper on the web. This is the City of the Silent, a website with information about cemeteries. Meet Joe Malloy. He's a deadhead who built the ultimate online shrine to Jerry Garcia. If you're into animals, we'll show you the virtual pet cemetery. And meet Michelle Weaver. She used to be an educator. Now she runs a very alive website called Toontown. And if you have a macabre sense of humor, we'll show you the Wells pop cult death pool. The Grim Reaper on the web, this week at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is brought to you by Z-Auction, the live online shopping experience. Additional funding from PC Connection and Mac Connection, the catalog and online superstore with PC and Mac products, toll-free technical support, and overnight delivery. And by Windows Magazine, delivering desktop, enterprise, and internet computing news, reviews, features, and how-tos for a Windows world, because the world runs on Windows. Additional funding from SoftSource Incorporated, publishers of Pro One Software, educational software for young adults.
Well, we're talking about the Grim Reaper on the web, the subject of death on the web, which you would think it'd be kind of morbid, but some of these sites are actually kind of funny, aren't they?
Yeah, I think we're having a little fun here with death, believe it or not. There's a couple of games out there where you can actually try to pick the next five celebrities that are going to die. And if you get it right, you win prizes.
Certainly irreverent, there's no question about that.
Yeah. Who would you pick?
Well, that could go on forever, but I bet there was a few people didn't pick last year, that's for sure.
I mean, you think you can sort of, is that an appropriate thing to have on the web, all this sort of sick stuff about
death? You know what, I think a lot of people don't like to talk about it, so I think if you can find a vehicle, whether it's comedy or whether it's more emotional, like the virtual pet cemetery for me, I think it's good. Any way that you can express your feelings is a good thing.
I agree with you. You know, I mean, death, I mean, there's a lot of grief and grieving in death, and people get through that by talking it out with other people. I think the net really provides an opportunity for people
sharing
to get comfortable and get, you know, get this the pain off your chest. Or
a good example is the Jerry Garcia shrine.
Exactly.
You know, people were so upset when he died.
People have a need to do that, and the web gives them that opportunity.
Right.
So, Joel, you've created a website. It's called The City of the Silent. And it's, I guess from my perspective, the one-stop shop for anybody who's interested in graveyard histories and the whole anthropological aspect of death and dying. Tell me a little bit about the things that I would find if I went to your website.
In developing City of the Silent, I've tried to put an emphasis on cemetery culture, remembering that cemeteries are places primarily for the living, places where we engage with the fact of death. And so my site includes things from a reader sharing board to a collection of epitaphs to a discussion of cemetery symbolism, a timeline of history, and even a reader sharing page where people can tell about what they have discovered. Because that's one of the most interesting things about taking part in any field of knowledge is sharing your discoveries.
Yeah, it was actually really interesting because when I went to your site, I guess I had this preconceived idea that the topic of cemeteries was a morbid one and somewhat twisted, and I expected to see vampires, and that's not at all the experience that I had. I mean, when I went there, as you say, there was a discussion about symbolism and depending on different cultures, the different aspects of it. So from my perspective, it was a really fascinating site. What's the feedback been from the people who've gone to your site? What were the experiences that they talked about?
Many people find it wonderful and are very pleased to find a site where they can realize their interest in cemeteries. Some people have been brought up to think that interest in cemeteries is very sick. And for this reason, I coined the term taphophilia, which is love of tombstones, to distinguish us from necrophiliacs.
Yeah, which is a completely different thing.
Which is something, something we can't discuss.
So typically, in England, I remember as a child, we used to go to the graveyards and we'd do rubbings of the tombs. And that's another thing that you've got at your website as well. So I mean, even for kids, that they could go and do tomb rubbings, and there's actually a...
Provided they take the proper precautions. I wouldn't do it on an old stone.
No, okay.
But on granite stones, it's just fine. Granite is very strong, but I think we need to be aware that with our old heritage, that some of the softer limestones and slates
can
be damaged by tombstone rubbing.
Now, another thing about your site is you had a massive list of links to other sites, and it also broadened my horizon in seeing the scope of the things that are out there that are not so much ghoulish, but actually educational and informative sites. What are some of the sort of the highlight sites that you'd like to to mention?
Well, I like Larry Kestenbaum's The Political Graveyard, which is a list of politicians buried around the country. I like the Orange County Coroner's page, which gives you a different view on death.
So the Coroner's page, what's that about?
Well, one of the most interesting features is they have a list with pictures and dental records of missing persons they have found over the years who still remain unidentified. And I find it impressive that out of all the millions of people in Orange County, there only seem to be about 40 people who are unknown.
That's pretty amazing when you consider the number of people that go missing. What are some other sites that you like?
Wendell White's The Cemetery is a fascinating site that deals with a small black American cemetery in New Jersey that Wendell discovered and just started doing research on and found out things about their farming, how they lived. These were free blacks before the Civil War, and it's revealing an angle of history that is not often looked into.
No, it's really interesting. It's so true, because going to your site, I saw a lot of things that gave me some insight into the way people lived over periods of time, and you know, talking about epidemics and you know, children's graveyards and so on and so forth. Really fascinating stuff.
For URLs of today's featured websites, check out the Internet Cafe site at cmptv.com.
Joe, you've created Jerry Garcia's Hate Street Shrine on the web. And
right.
I got to ask you a question. I think you're kind of a Jerry Garcia aficionado at this point. Is Jerry really dead, or is he still out there somewhere?
He's actually either on the web as source code, I think, or he is out there in some other fashion in everyone's hearts.
Definitely.
Some people have said he might
definitely
be in their lava lamps, but that's another story.
Right. He was really a beloved character, and
right,
I'm sure
exactly
that's what probably prompted you to create this site. How did this begin?
Well, it was actually the day that Jerry Garcia died, which was a sad day.
Mm-hmm.
It was actually a sad day on the net,
mm-hmm,
and I was at work and decided at the end of the day that I'd go out to the Hate Street shrines that I knew were going to be happening at
right
that time.
And people
I lived,
were out there on the streets.
People were out there, so I went and I took pictures of that with my digital camera and tried to capture the event as much as I could. Went back home, put that on the web, linked it up with various Grateful Dead sites that immediately gave feedback,
mm-hmm,
and then I got a lot of feedback from other people that were mourning his death
so
all over the world.
So people came to this site, people were
right
interested. Now you said it was a sad day on the net when that happened. Now the
right
sort of the myth or the stereotype would be sort of that, you know, deadheads, maybe they're not really into technology.
Well, I disagree.
Right,
I mean, they were.
Like
I think, you know, I ran into it, and it's evident in my guest book, which I have.
Mm-hmm.
There are a lot of
so people sign in when they
a lot
come
of people
to
sign in and,
mm-hmm,
and leave, you know, what they do,
mm-hmm,
and a lot of people were involved with, you know, the internet technology at that time.
Right.
A lot of very intelligent people that were also deadheads.
Okay, so it is a stereotype.
Right, exactly.
Now you said that you know, you had a deep caring for Jerry Garcia. So how have you memorialized him on this site? What are some of the things that are up there?
Well, it's sort of a work in progress. My site,
mm-hmm,
it didn't really just end with his death. Then
mm-hmm,
it's you know, almost
ongoing.
It's an ongoing
right
thing where I'm also, you know, I'm getting whoever signs in the guest book, as well as I'm adding various
mm-hmm
other multimedia things that I add to the
mm-hmm
site to amuse people, to make people laugh, to make people have fun
so,
with
so
the site.
So photos are something.
Photos,
and, yeah.
Shockwave, I've got some Java,
mm-hmm,
I've got various other types of
so
formats, some songs,
things,
some
right
real
now, that's
audio.
That's a question, actually. I
right
mean, obviously Grateful Dead, the music was their thing.
Right, exactly.
So do you actually have Grateful Dead music up there?
Well, I've got real audio of the last show
really
that he did, or that they did in Chicago.
How'd you get that?
Got it through a friend who was also a Grateful Dead fan who had some real audio that he digitized
wow
of the site.
Okay.
That was one view.
So that's worth checking out right there.
Well, it's worth checking
yeah
out. You can actually listen to the last songs that the Dead played together as
mm-hmm
a band while you look at these photos.
Mm-hmm.
There's links to other Grateful Dead sites. There's some Shockwave. You know, I try to make it as entertaining as possible where people can just kind of look and watch it. And there's some other Shockwave, which I did recently, which you can actually touch parts of Jerry Garcia's face and different guitar riffs come up. And you can
oh, really?
Just sort of have an improvisational Grateful Dead Jerry experience of yourself.
Right. Well, that sounds
yourself
like the summer of love all over again.
Right,
we'll
exactly
have to go check it out.
Right, exactly. Also, with the speaking of the summer of love, I've got a QuickTime VR of the Love in Golden Gate
oh,
Park.
Oh, the whole concert.
The 30th.
As well.
Well, not the whole concert. Just a view of what that was.
And you can rotate.
And if you're sharp, you'll be able to see that there is actually a picture of Jerry Garcia in the crowd.
Okay.
if you use the QuickTime VR.
Good. So we'll go check thing. It. We'll go check right. it out and see if we can find him in the crowd.
Right. Exactly.
For URLs of today's featured websites, check out the Internet Cafe site at cmptv.com. Some of the so-called death sites on the web are really very educational, historical, and downright innovative. One of them is a site called Tombtown. And Michelle, that was your creation, and I'm glad you're here tonight.
Thank you.
I want to ask you, where'd you get the strange idea to build a virtual cemetery on the web?
One of our projects included a genealogical research. And during the process of going through the cemeteries and finding our study
so
subjects.
So you're actually going through real cemeteries doing work like
many,
that?
Many, many cemeteries.
Yeah.
And it became very interesting to find that we became more and more curious, not so much about our current study, but the people around them. We saw headstones there
yeah.
with people we had no idea who they were about.
So you see a name and years and
exactly.
you don't know who they were.
So we thought, well, heck, why don't we do a 3D VR rendition
yeah.
of cemeteries? And in its virtual form, you're able to
learn about these dead, famous dead people.
Exactly.
Now let's talk about the 3D VR part of it. That is really cool, because when I went there, you can actually walk through the cemetery, make a left, go down this, and to kind of explore. It becomes a real adventure.
It's very fun. You go through, there are certain paths that you can take, and you are able to walk up to and around all of the tombstones.
Yeah.
There's also a tour in Tombtown that you can take. It's a click of a button, and it flies you around and shows you all the different elements that you can use.
All right, so let's say we're walking through Tombtown right now, and I come across the Marilyn Monroe tomb.
Right.
Now, I can click on that stone and find out about her?
Yes, her image comes up in a text, and you have her birth and her death. It gives a lot of information about her childhood, how she grew up, the impact that she had on the people around her, and the impact that the people around her had on herself.
Hmm.
And we also tried very hard at making sure that we had information that is not generally well known in the
yeah.
public concerning each individual resident.
What kind of people have you included in your cemetery? I mean, I saw Albert Einstein and Bela Lugosi and Marilyn, all the... How many people and what kinds of people do you select?
We have very famous people. We have celebrities, authors, scientists, historians, Plato, for example.
Yeah.
And we also have everyday people. We have regular people like you and I who wish to bury themselves or a loved one or a pet.
You can bury yourself even if you're alive?
Even if you're alive.
Okay.
You can be immortal.
Get all the glory without
exactly.
having to die.
One person, for example, thought it would be cute to bury themselves as an atheist, and they said, off to find off for myself.
Yeah. But so, seriously, I mean, if a loved one I know actually dies, I could then go to the website and say, I want this person to be in Tombtown.
Yes. You purchase a plot, you purchase a headstone, you provide the obituary, and anything that you want to write about this person, anything that you want the world to know
yeah.
about your loved one, they'll be able to.
That's cool.
Put
so
online.
People exploring these famous people could bump into my friend and click and find out who he or she
exactly,
was also.
Exactly, right next to any famous person. And
yeah.
and you have the option of being buried next to anybody and making special requests.
All right, now one of the cool things, you have a Princess Diana memorial there. Tell us about that.
Right. When Princess Diana was killed, we were one of the first websites to provide a memorial for her.
Mm-hmm.
People wrote in and gave their sentiments and remembrances. We compiled a book and sent it off to
wherever I sent it off to.
And in the meantime, we decided that a memorial would be feasible. You can't go and visit her grave. So we set up this memorial. You can visit the memorial, and then you can still write your remembrances, condolences.
So you can actually, I guess the next step is virtual funerals. I mean, you can actually have people around the world signing a condolence book for just a normal person.
That's absolutely true. And we've had several inquiries to do just that.
Well. And how do you, I mean, do you add people every week? I mean, a famous person dies, do they get into Tombtown?
It is very time consuming,
yeah.
and we do as much of it as we can. It's not updated as much as we'd like, obviously. But yeah, famous people die, they get in there. And then there's still so many people out there that we can include. We're in the process of building several more cemeteries that would be specific to groups.
Well, it's really well done. Tombtown. Thanks, Michelle.
For URLs of today's featured websites, check out the Internet Cafe site at cmptv.com.
So, Christian, celebrity deaths are sort of a huge phenomenon, something everybody's fascinated about. You see the tabloids in the supermarket. They just never seem to stop. Of course, why wouldn't it come to the web as well?
Right.
Now, tell me about, I've heard these things, death pools, and I think they're kind of all over the web. What is a death pool?
It's pretty basic. You know, you if you're in a pool, you pick famous people, celebrities, they're on your team, and if one of them dies, you win.
So it's a game, basically, and you're playing lottery with celebrities'
basically.
Lives.
Exactly. Okay. Yeah. Well, yeah, I guess.
Right. So who plays these kind of games, and what are the rules?
Well, my pool has a lot of people, and I'm not the only pool by a stretch. So there's hundreds or thousands of people playing
out there.
The rules on mine are pretty simple. You pick five people.
Okay.
One of them dies, and you win. You win the pool.
Easy.
Yeah.
Easy. Now, what is the definition of who you pick? What is it? A celebrity? Does it have to be a movie star? What?
It's kind of intentionally vague. It's basically someone has to be well known or a famous celebrity. And you know, some people are obvious, big movie stars and politicians.
Right.
But you know, some people are a little more questionable, and since it's my pool, I choose whether or not they're famous enough.
Right.
I haven't turned anybody down. If they can prove who they are, then I let it go.
Then I let them go. Okay, now when people pick, are they sort of going for the easy targets, you know, the maybe the older, the infirm, or is there like more points if you get somebody that wasn't expected or something like that?
I don't do more or less points, so, you know, right now, just about all the people, I thought that just about all the people who are close to death had been picked, but then somebody dies that nobody had. But Frank Sinatra and Bob Hope are probably the two biggest. Catherine Hepburn.
Okay.
You know, so old people that are really well known.
Yeah.
And then people tried to go with kind of dark horse picks.
Uh-huh.
Someone a little bit younger that maybe.
Partier.
So like Johnny Depp and people like that.
Okay. Robert Downey Jr. or someone
he's
known with drugs or something like that.
You know, that might have a little more of a higher risk factor.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Now, does someone get involved with this? They just come to your site and sign up, or?
Well, right now it's only for people who are on the well, which is subscription only. But I'm going to open up this pool. Start a new pool web-wide. I'm in a couple of other pools, and you get a lot of people, and you get a wider variety of people.
So you think it's going to be popular?
Yeah, I mean, the one site that I go to all the time even has a community, has message boards.
Oh, so
talk
people
about,
are,
you know, is this person dead? What do you think about this person? So, you know, people talk about it. People are interested.
Yeah.
So.
All right, now, Christian, I got to say one thing. This sounds a little bit sick, okay? So I'm just curious. Are the people playing it, is it fun? Is it sick? Is it a little bit of both?
I think it's a little both.
What do you
think? It's a little both. You know, we don't play for money.
Okay.
I think that would be a little bit too
much.
I think if I won, I would feel bad if I made money off somebody's death.
Right. And especially if it was a lot of money and it might inspire someone to go out and actually
and then, you know, then
I could
probably get in trouble.
Right.
You know?
So you don't want to do that. So what can you win?
Basically, when somebody wins, the other people in the pool send them a trinket, whether it's a keychain or a you know, like a funny book or just some random
nothing
real big, just a little kind of memento.
Right. So. And I also saw up on your site, there's some statistics about, you know, sort of what people pick. What are the most popular category that people
pick? I think actors and musicians. Actors, because they're well known, and musicians, rock stars.
Right.
You know, they have a history of dying young.
Kind of makes sense.
Exactly.
And what's sort of your third pick on that list?
Politicians. A lot of, you know, the presidents and ex-presidents and people in the Senate and European presidents and things like that.
Right.
So.
Makes sense. Yeah. I also saw you have some of your fans' poetry and stuff up there.
Mm-hmm.
Can you repeat the John Denver poem?
Sure. One of the Doug Moody is the guy's name who writes these poems for me. And his John Denver poem said, "Teach me Rocky Mountain High, just don't teach me how to fly." So.
Okay. On that note, let's go check out the site.
Okay.
For URLs of today's featured websites, check out the Internet Cafe site at cmptv.com.
So, Steve, you've got a website. It's the Virtual Pet Cemetery.
Yeah.
And you and your wife work on this website. Now, what prompted you to start a pet cemetery?
I've always been interested in death and how people react to death under different situations. And the web, at the time we started, was the very beginning of the web. And we wanted to start a new community to see how people would deal with death in this new environment of the web and how they could express themselves.
So it was an experiment, basically.
It was an experiment.
To find out how people dealt with death.
We had no idea what we'd get. When we first put it up, the first day we had 3 responses.
Wow.
And it was amazing. We didn't think people would respond for 3 months. We didn't even know how they found our website, let alone that they were responding so quickly.
So now why would you pick a pet cemetery, though? Why would you pick an animal to...
Because, well, a human cemetery we thought was too close to home. And personally, I wouldn't want to share the feelings about my relatives with people on the net. But people are much more open when it comes to pets. They'll say things that you wouldn't go into your office and just talk on and on and on about a relative who died. It would make everybody uncomfortable.
Right.
But people are more open to speaking about their pets.
So as the experiment goes on, obviously it's grown pretty substantially. What's the outcome? What were the summaries of your experiment?
It's very interesting. What we found is that people deal with death in different ways. Mm-hmm. Some people are very reserved about it and don't want to reveal too much. Other people say everything.
Right.
Some people are very humorous about the whole situation and want to treat it in a light way, in almost a fun way. And other people are very serious.
So people react differently to it as well. I mean, I know when I went to the site, and I've recently lost a pet in our family, and I was getting kind of emotional reading some of these things. There were some pretty sensitive stories that were being told.
Yes. That's the other thing that's very interesting about the Virtual Pet Cemetery is it's an emotional site.
Definitely.
Most sites on the web today are informational. They give you information. This really, they're stories about people's lives.
Yeah.
And how they deal with such a tragedy. And it's so emotional. My wife, who works on the cemetery with me, she cries when she reads the epitaphs.
So now tell me, if I wanted to post an epitaph for my pet, how would I go about doing that?
It's very simple. There's a page which says submit epitaph, and then you just send us email.
So it's that simple?
That simple.
And I can post my picture of my pet and do all those things as well?
We don't post everything.
Okay.
And that's a very delicate situation because we want epitaphs that we don't want somebody to just slap something down there and put it up. It would be disrespectful to all the other people who have put their epitaphs on the site. So if we feel somebody's serious and they've really thought about what they're writing, we'll definitely post it. We just want to make sure that it's appropriate for the site.
Absolutely. It is a sensitive topic. What are some of the best stories that come to mind for you that have been posted at the website?
There are so many good ones, and it's a very personal decision,
right,
what you like. I like the touch turtle, which is the very first.
That's the first story, yeah.
Yes.
That was great.
I thought it was wonderful, and I thought it had, for me, it was tragic, but it was funny also, and it was very touching.
And I think the net on that story was about this particular type of turtle that didn't actually die.
Right. It's the story about a kid who has a turtle, and he thinks his turtle has died, and so he digs a grave in the backyard and he buries the turtle, and then a couple months later he finds out that turtles hibernate in the winter. And well, hopefully the turtle crawled out of the hole.
But. Yeah, but you never know. But there's lots of other stories as well. It's a great site. Thanks so much, Steve.
So do you have a favorite death website now, Andrew?
It's kind of sad to say your favorite death website.
The whole thing is weird.
Here, it is. But, you know, the Grateful Dead site I thought was pretty neat. It was kind of a real memorial, and it was a place where people could go. I didn't know that the deadheads or the hippies, if you will, really intersect with the web culture. You wouldn't think they're online, but really were a big part of it. So I thought that was good, and I thought it was fun to play the celebrity game, too.
You think that's funny? Who's going to die next?
I think it's kind of funny, and if I had picked Sonny Bono, maybe I would have been winner, too.
Well, so. I guess you have to loosen up a little bit about the subject, right? I mean,
right.
It's too depressing.
Right.
So people
exactly.
have to have fun with
make
it.
Fun
with,
make fun
what
with it.
Do you think?
For me personally, I just recently lost a member of our family. One of our pets was killed by a car, and I thought that the Virtual Pet Cemetery was a really great idea because you don't often get the chance to talk about how you feel about losing a pet, and it's a great place
to
be able to find community.
Dealing with death is a
there.
Ritualized kind of thing, and this sort of helps create that
it's
ritual.
It's really good.
Well, Toontown, I thought it was great, too, because very educational, great interface. I mean, the subject really wasn't death, but history, so I thought that was a good example. If you'd like any more information about any of the websites we saw tonight, check out our website at cmptd.com, and we'll see you here next week at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is brought to you by Z-Auction, the live online shopping experience. Additional funding from PC Connection and Mac Connection, the catalog and online superstore with PC and Mac products, toll-free technical support, and overnight delivery. And by Windows Magazine, delivering desktop, enterprise, and internet computing news, reviews, features, and how-tos for a Windows world, because the world runs on Windows. Additional funding from SoftSource Incorporated, publishers of Pro One Software, educational software for young adults. To purchase a videotape copy of today's program, call toll-free 1-888-310-7850. Please specify the show number and the topic.